Hello, I'm Jamie, and for this short video, I'm joined by the author, Dominic Couzens, who's got a new book out, Save Our Species. We'll be talking about that in a bit. But Dominic, welcome. And we're going to hear from you, I think, today, a few really key tips of simple things, fairly simple things people can do to save nature.
Yes, that's right. Nice to speak to you, Jamie, and thank you for inviting me on.
Let's begin with one. So we're going to talk you through five today. And the first one, I think, is quite, it really resonates with us at the RSPB, and that's citizen science. Can you tell us what that is and how people can get involved?
Yes, absolutely. Citizen science is essentially making observations of your own and then sharing them with the relevant organisations. When I wrote the book, it occurred to me that they're very much more important than people realise. So if you do your big garden bird watch in January, you probably emphasise on the fact that it's so much fun and you see birds and you spend a nice time doing it. But what you may forget is how important it is. And then you can do other things like spotting bumblebees and mapping mammals. There's a mammal mapper app, which you can download onto your phone, and you can record almost everything. And the exciting thing is it's tremendous fun for you and absolute gold dust for all the organisations who are trying to study the fortunes of wildlife.
Absolutely. And as you say, it's not just us at the RSPB. There are all sorts of organisations that you can join in with. Just have a look at the websites of all the major, certainly the UK conservation charities, and you will find there will be a piece of citizen science there, won't there, for you to take
part in. There will. It's everywhere. And to be honest, even a single observation is useful, and it's better than no observation at all. For example, where I live recently, I saw a weasel. And weasels are one of those mammals which people don't see very often. So every time they're recorded is actually quite important. But things like hedgehogs, the reason it's so important is that 25, 30 years ago, nobody would have thought of recording sparrows. But now sparrows are really important. Everyone recognizes that they've been declining. They're now, I think, doing slightly better. But had we not recorded sparrows in the first place many years ago, we would never have realised that they're declining. And of course, sparrows and many other things, hedgehogs particularly, tend to be seen around people's gardens. And so information from gardens, information from you today is important to get the whole picture of wildlife in Britain.
So now we're going to get slightly political with a small p, because we're going to be talking about contacting your parliamentary representatives, your political leaders, and getting them on side. What's the best way to do this?
It's remarkably easy, actually, to contact any of our parliamentary representatives or whatever level there are. For example, websites that enable you to go straight can actually tell you who your local MP or MSP, wherever you are in the country, wherever they are. You can find out their email address at Parliament, so you can simply drop them an email. And you could even just literally a one-liner can be enough, saying, look, I care about grouse shooting, or I care about this, that, and the other. Just to say you care, and this is what you think, this is my opinion, and that may not be, you may not need to do any more than that. And it will actually sink in.
And you have to be a little bit diplomatic, don't you, when you're writing to someone like this?
Absolutely, Jamie. We all think of our MPs and government representatives, wherever they may be in the country, in a rather sort of cartoonish manner. And the fact is, they're all people, just like you and me. They're all people. They like to be told that they're doing a good job, and if they are, they should be told if you agree with what they're doing. And what they don't want is to be shouted at, because normally your regional representatives or your national representatives, what they tend to hear is people who are either angry or desperate. And it will come as a breath of fresh air to them if someone comes who's neither and is actually very polite, but nevertheless has a persistent point to make in a cogent and sensible manner. And obviously that sort of thing is going to make far more of an impression on them, depending what you're actually saying. And if they hear enough people, hear from enough people who are calmly going to put a point forward, they are going to eventually form an opinion that might be different to the one they come with. The other important thing to remember is that your MP or other representative might disagree with you. And you've got to be able to cope with that, because they have every right to disagree with you. You might think you're better informed or this, that and the other, but they have an opinion, their opinion counts too.
The third one, you've talked about being angry. So getting angry on social media. Now, getting angry on social media can result in all sorts of different things. And you have to kind of get angry constructively, don't you, if you want to make a change, if there's a local issue that's a local burning issue or even a national issue that you really care about.
Yeah, I would take the example of councils trimming verges, or worse, spraying verges full of wildflowers, which are being pollinated by bees and so on and so forth. Now, it's very easy for you to get very angry about that if you think, you quite reasonably think that the council might be wasting money by spraying a verge near you, which is probably true. But there is a way that you can use your anger, and that is to contact your local council, maybe through a social media outlet. Twitter, for example, is a very immediate one. And if you get to the right people, then you're very likely to have a response. What you need to do is not be so angry, but actually to slightly embarrass them is quite a good way of
calling
doing
them
it.
Out, isn't it? It's called calling them out. On social media.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, like, there was a good example recently about the netting, which was stopping kittiwakes nesting. I think it was up in the northeast. Might have been in East Anglia. I can't remember exactly. But some kittiwakes were being prevented going to their nests by netting. And there was quite a big campaign run over social media, and it certainly had some effect. And so it's not always, you're not always going to get the answer you want. But even if it's this year you make the point, next year you might get a change. And so it's very important. And why not just use social media for a good purpose? A lot of people don't. You have to, again, I would really say, don't be critical of the person, be constructive. Because often somebody doesn't realise what they're doing. They're not all nature nerds like you and I, Jamie. So they're not necessarily going to realise. And so you've got to approach them in a way that's, they might think, oh, I hadn't thought of that, rather than, oh, I'm not going to listen to them.
Yeah, I think that's the key thing. You don't throw around insults. You point out what's wrong. You show a vision of what's right and what would be good for everybody. I think that's a really good point. So we've got a couple more actually on the same theme. Take it back to your own garden or your balcony, yes, or your window box or whatever you've got. There's so much you can do. And on our Nature on Your Doorstep part of our website, our new section of our website, there's loads of tips. But Dominic, you've been doing this in your garden yourself as well, haven't you? Making homes for nature.
Absolutely. And there's so many different things you can do. The fact that you care about wildlife is a fantastic start. It means, for example, that you're less likely to put a plastic lawn down. Plastic lawns are a bad idea. I know that there are certain people who may have difficulty gardening and might put plastic down, and that's obviously fine. But when it's just for a sort of fashionable purposes, you're being lazy, or something like that, please don't do that. So most people who are listening wouldn't do such a thing. But you can do things like, we've just had, fairly recently, we had no mow May, which meant that people tried not to mow their lawn. It's only you only need to do it a few times a year. But again, you have to choose. You may find that your garden is in an area where everyone mows their lawns and people care about it. You don't want to upset your neighbours, you want to inspire your neighbours. Same issue again that we've been talking about. Yeah, so for my garden, I have mowed the lawn just now, but I mowed round a beautiful patch of white clover. And white clover is a fantastic flower for bees. And I could see them all pollinating whilst I mowed around them. So I left the gap. And everyone can leave untidy corners. You've probably heard this loads of times, but again, you see the everyone will probably have heard that if you add your garden on its own, doesn't make a difference, but everyone else's garden added together makes an enormous difference. Incredible. No one realizes just how much the power of individuals actually is. Again, it's like writing to your MP. If you do it and someone else does it, someone else, it's the, of course, you on your own may not make much of a difference, you might not think, but you are one of a group, and the more in the group, the more power there is. So again, anything you do in your garden is kind of multiplied around the countryside, if you like.
Absolutely, and you can make it look beautiful. I should say that No Mow May is an initiative by our wonderful friends at Plant Life, and our own meadow that we've got in our garden at home, we mow to create paths and then leave the rest, and
they look fantastic.
I love it
when you get a mowed path through a meadow. Absolutely beautiful. Everyone wins.
Yeah, and it's sort of an immersive experience walking through it. Your final fifth thing you can do to save our species. I think this is a really beautiful one. And this is about visiting a nature reserve. So tell us a bit about this one.
Well, what could be easier? You're probably into wildlife and visiting a nature reserve, but why don't you take someone who's not normally used to it? And so you have there's a number of ground rules that you can do if you take someone for the very first time for a nature reserve, and that is to just make sure they enjoy it. So don't necessarily go for too long, and let them talk, let them take it in. Don't go with the impression that there's some kind of code of conduct for nature reserves, because that's not going to get people from a state of not necessarily being engaging with nature to a state where they're going to get keen, because they might get put off. And I think it's incredibly important at this stage in our sort of conservation life as a country that we need to be incredibly gracious to people now. People who come out into the countryside, maybe they leave litter behind, maybe they let their dogs loose, maybe they do things that a lot of people might frown about, but I think we just have to be so gracious now and say, just get them out there, let them have a fantastic time. Maybe in a few extra visits, they'll begin to realize it might not be a great idea to leave a barbecue or something. But I think it's important now, whilst nature hangs in the balance, we need everybody on board, everyone to get involved from all walks of life, everybody. If we can get them out into nature and make them feel welcome, whoever they are, there's some excellent initiatives going on in all walks of society at the moment, as you know. And there, more and more of that. We need everybody out there. We want everyone to have a stake in nature. It is, after all, it belongs to us all. Everyone can get a gift from nature, whoever they are. And so get them out there, and then one day they might conform to what we, you know, us experienced nature people might expect. Maybe they never will, but they might just then begin to pressurize the government into making nature-based decisions and that sort of thing. So we are in a process now where we need everyone on board. We need to be very inclusive in every sense.
I think you're right. And I think the issue is that we need to understand people are going to use the countryside in different ways.
Yes.
They're not all going to follow us out with their binoculars, however much we would like that.
No.
People are going to be wanting to do different things, outdoor sports, some form of exercise. There are all sorts of ways of enjoying nature. It doesn't mean that they don't care about the wildlife around them. It just means that they're enjoying it in a different way.
Absolutely. And I think sometimes we've been guilty in a sort of nature nerd, if we can call ourselves that, we've been guilty of judging people. We need to stop doing that. We really do, because as I said, it's quite important just to get those people to care if they don't already. And if they do care, to recognize their caring is just as important as our caring, who might have been involved in nature for many years.
Precisely. Thank you very much. And you can find these and many other tips in Dominic's new book, Save Our Species. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.